Yes, guys. So let's discuss about a very interesting standard now. And it is not a specific standard per se. It is generally applicable in every situation that you come across every day in, day out. Now, what standard is am I talking about? I am talking about a standard called IND AS 37. Peculiar standard, guys. Earlier under accounting standard, we had two standards discussing about this. And here we deal with provisions, contingent assets, and contingent liabilities. Earlier we had two standards for this. We were talking about contingent assets, contingent liabilities, and provisions as per AS4 as well as AS29. Now we have one single standard comprehensively discussing about these issues and plenty more issues than what were discussed as a part of AS4 and AS29. Now let's try to understand what exactly the standard is scoping in and what is it excluding out of its original scope. The standard predominantly talks about three things, that is provisions and contingencies. And under contingencies, we talk about contingent asset as well as liability. Now, however, we say that this standard specifically excludes number one, executory contracts. Now, we will talk about this executory contracts in a meanwhile. We will talk about this. Just give me some time. I'll come back to what executory contracts exactly are and why are they excluded from the scope of the standard. The second exclusion that I can discuss here is regarding financial instruments. All your financial instruments are governed as per IND AS 109. So you do not discuss as a part of IND AS 37 any further. Same way, we also exclude certain other items which are covered under some other standards. For example, revenue. Any provisions and contingencies relating to revenue specifically discussed as a part of IND AS 115. So I do not have IND AS 37 discussing about them. Same way, your income tax or deferred tax asset or liability. Deferred tax asset or liability. Your income tax, deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability is discussed as a part of IND AS 12. Similarly, we have exclusions relating to leases. All your leases are excluded as per IND AS 17. However, in a small situation, I will bring in the concept of lease under IND AS 37. I'll specify why I'm bringing that also, but not now. We'll discuss about that later on. Obligations arising under employment benefits or employee benefits. All obligations arising under employee benefits discussed as a part of IND AS 19. Similarly, exclusions also pertaining to contingent consideration. We have seen this word already when we were discussing about IND AS 103. Contingent consideration under business combination. Contingent consideration under business combination is specifically discussed as a part of IND AS 103, not covered under IND AS 37 by any chance. Similarly, we have H. We have one more exclusion regarding liabilities under insurance contracts. Your liabilities under insurance contract specifically dealt as per the standard IND AS 104. Long list of exclusions have been put in here And you need to understand that the specific exclusion is because those respective standards were discussing about the liabilities arising in that situation. For example, leases, your amount of lease liability, the measurement, the recognition and everything is specifically discussed as per the standard in Ind AS 17. Employment benefits, you have defined benefit obligations measured specifically as per that particular respective standard. So we do not have to deal with under this generic standard. So that is the reason why we exclude all these items. But first of all, I want to bring to the notice this one word which I was talking about, where I haven't discussed any place. I haven't written any standard right beside this. The reason is because executory contracts are peculiar nature, which are specifically excluded from the scope of Ind AS 37. What exactly do you mean by this word executory contracts? And why are they excluded from the scope? To explain, take an example like this. I have entered into an agreement and or a rate contract with a particular customer, and according to that particular rate contract, I have agreed saying that if I supply material, then at the rates which I already pre-negotiated with you, I will supply the quantity at that particular rate. The supplier, the customer bought the quantity, I supplied it to him, he paid them on. Story over. These are executory contracts because the part of performance based on my performance, he has already compensated me for my performance. There is no pending performance between both the parties. Or for example, he never raised an order, I never supplied the goods. So I did not do my performance, he did not do his performance, no one has actually executed their performance. Even such kind of contracts are excluded from the scope, and these are called as executory contract. To explain further, I will say that in executory contracts, no party has performed their obligations under the contract or both the parties executed equal amount of performance. These are the two things which I am talking about. No party has performed any of their obligation, or I have performed my obligation, he has also compensated me for my obligation, over. These are called as executory contracts, specifically excluded from the scope of the standard. However, he clearly said that executory contracts will be considered under Ind AS 37 if they are onerous in nature. I'm including something, and I said that executory contracts are covered under Ind AS 37 if they are onerous . Remember this term onerous, but remember this term onerous we have also used as a part of Ind AS 2. What are onerous contracts? The cost which is incurred to complete my performance is much higher than the benefit that I will receive from the contract. To fulfill that particular contract, whatever cost I incur is exceeding the amount of benefit derived from that contract. Such contracts are called as onerous, and onerous contracts are specifically dealt as per Ind AS 37. However, if I'm looking at executory contracts where none of the parties have executed any part of the performance, or both the parties have compensated their performance equally, then in such situation, such contracts are not covered under the ambit of Ind AS 37. Now, this is where we start the standard, but we'll have to specifically look at what are the conditions for recognizing a provision and what are the situations which lead to be recognized as provisions or contingent liabilities. Contingent asset is a significantly different concept or aspect which has to be discussed. Along with that, we also have to discuss about something called as levies in the standard. Now we'll talk about each part, explaining one by one in a stepwise manner. So we'll first look at provisions and contingent liabilities on what is the recognition criteria and what is the measurement of how it exactly is being done. So yes guys, so let's start talking about the recognition of a provision or a contingent liability. How do we say that something is a provision or a contingent liability? Or let me even compare what is a liability as well. Now I'll put it like this. To determine whether it is a contingent liability or a provision or a liability, it completely depends upon what is the certainty of outcome. Certainty of outflow of enterprise resources. Now I am saying all the three situations, whether you recognize a provision or you recognize a contingent liability or you recognize a liability by itself, everything depends upon outflow of enterprise resource. Or what do you mean by outflow? Outflow means it is a flowing out of the enterprise of what? Enterprise resources. What does this word enterprise resource mean? Enterprise resources is nothing but the value of net assets. When there's a certainty in the outflow of enterprise resources, you recognize either a provision or a liability or a contingent liability. How do I know what to recognize? Whether a provision or a contingent liability or a liability by itself will depend upon the certainty is what we are saying. Now let's say the outflow of enterprise resources is arising due to a present obligation or a possible obligation. I'm using the word obligation. I'll tell you what obligations normally an enterprise can assume. The certainty of outflow either arises due to present obligation or a possible obligation. Possible obligation, that means it is not an obligation today but might arise as an obligation in future. The word being used here is possible obligation. So that means could arise in future. Whenever you say it is possible obligation that could arise in future, I will recognize or I will consider it as contingent liability. But when I'm looking at the present obligation, this is where the entire crux falls into. Let's understand under present obligation what we have. If I'm looking at the obligation being present, then that present obligation should arise from past event. Arising from past event. And when a present obligation arises from a past event, I will try to identify what is the probability of outcome. If I say probability of outcome, now my probability of outcome can be given in three ways. If I'm looking at the probability of outcome being virtually certain, I'll tell you what virtually certain means. if the probability of outcome of a present obligation arising from a past event resulting in an outflow of enterprise resources is virtually certain, in such cases I will recognize a provision. If the possibility of outcome or probability of outcome is probable to occur, I'm saying it is probable for the present obligation to result in an outflow of enterprise resources, in such cases we will start looking at whether it can be reasonably measured or no. If you say that it can be reasonably measured, then you recognize it as provision. If you say that I am not able to reasonably measure the amount of outflow of enterprise resources, then you recognize it as contingent liability. There's also a third probability which arises and uses the word remote. That means there is a present obligation arising from a past event where it could result in a possibility of outflow of enterprise resources, but the possibility of such event to occur is very remote. In such situation, I will treat it again as contingent liability itself. So that means I am saying that for me to recognize a provision, I will have a present obligation which is arising from past event resulting in outflow of enterprise resources. And the probability of occurrence, if it is virtually certain, I will recognize. Or even if it is probable to occur, I will recognize. Provided I should be able to ensure that it can be measured reliably. If I can reliably measure it or reasonably measure it, in such situation I'll recognize a provision. If I'm not able to measure it, then I'll recognize a contingent liability here. Now this in a sense will help you explain the differentiation between provision and contingent liability. But we had some other word also called as liability. Liabilities are present obligations where the amount or the timing of outflow of enterprise resources can be determined with certainty. That means that we are saying I would call it as a liability if it is a present obligation and it is arising from a past event, and the amount and timing when the outflow of enterprise resources occur can be determined with reasonable amount of certainty. Now, for example, I would say that if it cannot be measured certainly, that there will be an amount and timing is uncertain. If the amount or timing is uncertain, then I'll recognize a provision if it can be reliably measured. If this word reliable measurement is not there, if there is no reliable measurement, then in such case treat it as contingent liability. Look at the situation now. I've linked all the three words now. I've somehow made sure that there's a link which is being formed. Let's bring it up now. Understand? I have a present obligation arising from a past event. For example, let's say I purchase certain goods. Certain goods which I purchased from a particular supplier, I already had an order. The supplier has given me an invoice. So there is an obligation to pay. Such obligation to pay will result in outflow of enterprise resource because I'll have to in future pay him in cash. Cash is an asset which is an outflow. Now, since it is resulting in an outflow and the person to whom I'm paying, the time at which I'm paying, he has given me 30-day credit. So after 30 days, I have to make the payment. I know the amount of the payment because he has given me the invoice. If all these are certain, then I will make sure that I will directly recognize a liability, present obligation where the amount or timing of the outflow can be determined with reasonable certainty. Then you recognize it as a provision. Then you recognize it as a liability. Let's say, for example, the supplier has given me a particular invoice, but he said it is subjected to certain negotiation. As on today's day, there is no certainty of the amount. Yes, there is a certainty for the timing. He said after 30 days, you have to pay, sir. But there's a negotiation which is happening. Sir, with this invoice value which you have quoted is slightly high, sir. I've already supplied the goods. There is a liability. I've already assumed it. I agree, but I have to pay. But the amount which you have quoted in the invoice, sir, I'm not really so happy with it. So let us sit and negotiate. The supplier also said, yes, sir, no problem. We are ready to negotiate because you have been a really good customer for us. At such point of time, I will say that the amount is not really certain, but I can reliably measure how much amount of discount can he give over the invoice value. Maybe probably I might get about 10% or 15% of a discount, not more than that. So due to our customer relationship, since he might provide some discount to me right now, I cannot record it as a liability because there is no certainty of the amount. Since we lack certainty of the amount, since it is uncertain, I will think about whether I can reliably measure it or not. Let's say I could reliably measure it. I came out with the valuation saying that, sir, invoice value is 100 rupees. On a regular basis, these people have been offering a discount of 10%, which on negotiation could be the same value. In such situation, instead of recognizing a liability, I will recognize it as a provision. Let's say I did not receive the invoice only. What is the value of good? I don't know, sir. I needed it in emergency, so I already used it. Do you have an obligation to pay? Yes, sir, I have an obligation to pay because I received the good. What amount will you pay? That I don't know, sir. Because he did not give me any invoice. I'm waiting for his invoice to come. He has directly supplied the good. I've already made sure that the delivery is done to my customer. The supplier who has given the good to me, I don't know at what price he's going to supply to me. Okay, fine. Can you measure it reliably? If I can measure it reliably in such situation, then I will still recognize a provision. Sir, I'm not sure. Such good, for the first time I'm coming up in my life. So such way where there is no reliable measurement, I'll simply recognize it as contingent liability, or I'm not saying recognition, I'll treat it as contingent liability is what I'll put up. Here continuously I've been using a word called as present obligation. If it is a present obligation and if it is virtually certain, then recognize it as a provision. But it is not virtually certain, but it is probable that it will result in an outflow. And I can make sure that the measurement is done on a reliable basis. Then again recognize a provision. Sir, there is a probability that there will be an outflow, but I don't know how much amount. Like the case where we said, I've received the good from a supplier, the supplier did not give me an invoice. I don't know what is the fair value of that good. Since I cannot measure it reliably, I will treat it as a contingent liability. The possibility that he will charge for me is remote. By the way, is it remote, sir? Sir, I thought it was sample. I consumed it. Now he's saying, no, sir, you have to pay for it. There is a negotiation process, sir, but I know that he is gonna compulsory allow me that to take it as a sample. Then the possibility of outcome resulting in outflow of enterprise resources is remote. In such situation, I'll treat it as contingent liability. What is a possible obligation then? Possible obligations are always contingent liabilities. It is not even a current obligation. It is not even an obligation which I have to recognize it today. I am saying such obligation might result in future. It might come up in future. Sir, I am supplying the goon. But if in case it is found defective, in such situation, I will have an obligation to repair it. But is there a present obligation today? No, sir. Today there is no obligation. If there is any error which will occur, then I will have to create. Such warranties and guarantees will normally be treated as possible obligation when such error occurs. Sir, over the past, we have always been having the cases, sir. Out of 100 units that I sell, 15 units have been found defective. That means you can reliably measure it. I can reliably measure it that there will be an obligation. It's a present obligation that I have to consider. It is not possible. I am saying certain. 15% of my goods are always defective. Present obligation, measure it reliably, treat it as a provision, cannot be measured, again go treat it as contingent liability. Got it? So this in essence will give me a fair understanding of what we stand between those three terms, provisions, liabilities and contingent liabilities. However, guys, I've used certain words here called as obligation. What is an obligation and why does it actually arise? Let us start looking at, and what is this virtually certain, probable to occur, possible to occur, remote? How do we even define this? We'll come up with this now. Yes, guys, so we were talking about obligations, right? When we use the word past events, which result in future outflow, of what? Of enterprise resources. Are called as obligating events. Few past events which result in outflow of enterprise resources are called as obligating events. Now, whenever I find this obligation, what obligations am I talking about? When I look at the word obligations, this word obligation can arise due to two reasons. One is called as legal obligation or a constructive obligation. When I look at legal obligation, it arises due to a law or a prevailing statute or due to a contract or can arise due to a contract. When I'm looking at constructive obligations, these are normally arising due to your past practices or best practices. I'll tell you what this actually includes. I'm saying any past event which results in outflow of enterprise resource is called as obligating events. Such obligations can arise due to legal or constructive. Legal means an obligation which is arising due to law. Now, what is this arising due to law? I have an obligation for payment of income tax. So I create a provision for income tax. I have an obligation for payment of GST. I have an obligation for depositing your TDS. All these are basically legal obligations arising due to operation of law. There can be an obligation arising due to a contract. I have agreed to compensate 200 rupees or 2 lakh rupees for delivery of certain goods or services. So a liability which is arising or an obligation arising under a contract which is enforceable in court of law. Constructive obligation. I have been doing a mining and due to best practices, after I mine that particular place, I'll have to make sure that it is again filled up to the extent whatever I mined. So I'll make sure that there is some sand or mud which is collected from different places and again filled up in that zone where the mining has taken place. That is the best practice. My past practices have shown that. I have never committed to repair my particular product which I sold, but the best practice which I've been following since past is that whenever there is a faulty product or when there is a small fault as far as your particular product which is sold, I always made sure that I was doing the service free of cost. These are past practices which I have. These are called as obligations. Such obligations which arise due to either a legal obligation or could be due to a constructive obligation for me. Now, like we said, possible obligations and future obligations, present obligations, we have seen all this in identifying your contingent liabilities or a liability or a provision. Now, let's look further into the concept of what is this word provision. I will recognize a provision if there is a present obligation arising from past event results in future outflow of enterprise resources and can be measured reliably. In such situation, I will recognize something called as a provision. And if you remember, I also told you that this is a present obligation and not a possible obligation. If it's a possible obligation, then I will treat it as a contingent liability and not a provision by any chance. And I'm saying that. However, the present obligation also, we'll have to look at the situation of when is it virtually certain? When do you say that it is probable to arise? When do you say that it is possible to arise? When do you call it as a remote occurrence? Occurrence is remote. When I say it is virtually certain, that means the possibility of occurrence is more than 90%. My possibility of occurrence is more than 90%. Probable means it is greater than 50. Less than equal to 95, I'll call it as a probable occurrence. Possible occurrence means less than 50%, but greater than or equal to 5%. Remote occurrence means the occurrence is less than 5%. Under these two situations, if it falls, the future outflow of enterprise resources will result in provision. Under this situation where it is possible, I'll recognize or I'll treat it as contingent liability. If the occurrence is remote, then there is no treatment which is necessary. This is what we can understand with the help of a provision. So we are saying there is a present obligation resulting in a outflow of enterprise resources arising from a past event. Now such present obligation, if it is virtually certain or probable to arise, I will recognize a provision. If it is possible to arise, it is not arising today, but it might be possible. In such situation, I'll recognize it as a contingent liability, remote occurrence. Outflow of enterprise resources might occur, but the possibility of occurrence is very remote. In such situation, it is not even a contingent liability. You need not have any treatment for that. So I can leave it like that when the possibility of occurrence for outflow of enterprise resources can be remote. So I'm just saying that this possibility of occurrence, this is possibility of future outflow of enterprise resources . This is when we recognize a provision, and this is how the treatment should go on. Now understand with clear significance the percentages which I have applied. Now we'll have to further move into how do I measure it. Measurement of a provision becomes really important because the most important criteria here put up is reliable measure. If you cannot reliably measure a present obligation arising from past event, which could probably result in outflow of enterprise resource, but the measurement is not possible, then provision cannot be recognized. If 1, 2, 3 conditions are satisfied, fourth condition not satisfied, then it is not possible for us to recognize a provision. So I'm numbering it. Number 1, number 2, number 3, and number 4. All the four conditions are necessary to be satisfied. If it cannot be measured reliably, I will treat it as contingent liability. I will not treat it as provision. So measurement of a provision becomes really important in certain situations. Now let's see how do we measure a provision and how do we estimate the amount reliably for the future outflow of enterprise resources. Been understanding that measurement of a provision requires a kind of judgment, because we clearly said when I'm looking at a provision, it has to be reliably measured. When I'm looking at a provision, I said the conditions for recognition of a provision can be considered as a present obligation which is arising from a past event, and along with that we also said the terms being used out there are present obligation which is arising from past event, we continue to say that results in future outflow of enterprise resources probable, and finally the condition, last condition we have put in, is it can be measured reliably. Can be reliably measured. These were the conditions for us to recognize a provision. So when we're looking at a provision, all these conditions have to be satisfied. Now the first and the most important part which I wanted to look at here is the reliable measurement. So I'm using these four parts of recognizing a provision. It's a present obligation arising from a past event, future outflow of enterprise resources possible or probable, and reliably measured. And the last conditions become important, because if it cannot be measured reliably, then it should be treated as considered as a contingent liability. So that means reliable measurement is a very core concept for me to recognize any particular provision. If it can't be measured reliably, then it will be treated as a contingent liability. So what is this reliable measurement? let us discuss about measurement. My measurement of provision should be based on the best estimate of management. In simple terms, we are concluding and saying that it should be a best estimate of the management. Now, on what basis do we derive what is a best estimate? For us to determine something as a best estimate, then you need to understand that the best estimate should take into consideration the historic data. Should be the basis. That means I'll take the historic data as a basis and I will start identifying what is the best estimate of a provision. Now, when we are looking at a historic data being taken as a basis, understand that a person might come up to say like something like this. In the month of March, whatever I've sold, I've got 15% of defects. And I had an obligation, present obligation, arising from the sale of a transaction, which probably give me a future outflow of enterprise resource in the form of repair cost or replacement cost, which I have to incur. At the time of sale, I've guaranteed a customer that for 1 year period, I will make sure that your guarantees and warranties are given. So any repair, I will make sure that it is done at free of cost. Now I have to recognize a provision for such warranties and guarantees. My provision for warranty and guarantee should be based on historic data. Now, whenever we look at this word historic data out here, he has given me different ways of historic data. The one type of historic data he has given me a series of outcomes. Series of outcomes in the sense, he is telling me that there could be a probable 10 or 15 outcomes which are possible. Saying that if there are 10% defective, then this is the cost which I normally incur. If there are 15% defective item, this is the normal amount which I'll incur. If the 20% defective item, then this is the probable I'll incur. Now there are a series of outcomes which he has given. When such series of outcomes are given to us, then in such situation, the identification of a best estimate should be based on my best estimate is equal to the median. Median of the information means if I have 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 outcomes, a median of the outcome can be considered as the middle figure. This will be called as a median. For me to call it as a median, these items should be presented either in ascending or descending order. You can use whatever you want, but it should be in a particular order for me to determine that it is a median. Remember guys, if I have two items in the median or two numbers as median, we will take a simple average of those two outcomes to determine what is the amount of median in series of outcomes. Sometimes, let's say he did not give me a series of outcomes, instead he came out to give me the probability of outcomes. So he's saying me here I'll get series of outcomes, different outcomes I'll give. Here I'm talking about probability of outcomes. Probability of outcome in the sense, I have 10% probability that I will get a damage of 8%. In such case, the cost would have been so much. Now this way, different probabilities of items are given. There is 10% probability that there will be zero cost because no defects at all. There's 10% probability that I'll have a defect of 5%. There's 15% probability that I'll have a defect of 8%. There's 40% probability that I'll have defects of 9%. Like this, different probabilities are given. Whenever I have different probabilities of outcome, in such cases, my best estimate of provision should be based on a sum of probability into outcomes. A sum of probability and outcome is the best estimate of such cost that we are going to incur. Now, this is called as a best estimate of outcomes. Now, however, your provision is not just based on a historic data, but also has to consider even your future information as well. Now, how do I consider future information? And what is that which is relevant here? You have to take into consideration for recognizing a provision multiple aspects. What aspects will I consider? I will consider risk and uncertainties. All risk and uncertainty should be considered. I'll have to consider my time value of money. I'll have to consider risk and uncertainty which is attached to those outcomes. Time value of money of those outcomes have to be estimated or have to be taken into consideration for determining the amount of provision. So we'll have to see further more into identifying or measuring the value of provision exactly of what is the best estimate to be recognized in the financial year. So let us see what these are and what are the different types of risk and how do we adjust those risk. What is the time value? Sometimes we also consider future events. Future events are also considered in determining the fair value or determining the reliable measurement of a provision. Why is this future value considered and how does it even affect the amount of provision to be recognized? We'll have to understand in depth what exactly this means. Yes guys, so we were looking at the best estimate of provision and I said the best estimate of provision will take into consideration three things. What are those three things that will be taken into consideration to give a best estimate? Like I already told you, I'll have to take into consideration risk and uncertainties. I'll also have to take into consideration time value of money. I'll also have to take into consideration future events which could affect the value of provision. Future events that could affect the value of a provision. Now, risk and uncertainty. Risk and uncertainty could be based on the asset or a liability or an enterprise or an industry as a whole. That means, for a particular activity which is relating to construction compared to that with education or something like that, you will have a lot of difference. A retail segment person is affected by a lower amount of risk than a construction person. Now, these are industry-based risk. Asset-based risk. This asset is predominantly producing a new product which was never ever there in the market. Whether the customer will be ready to buy that or not, I am exposed to a risk. But if a product which is manufactured by this asset has been a regular product and is of a day-to-day use in the business in a man's life, then I would say that the risk of that particular asset is significantly lower. This way, I can influence a risk can influence either the asset or the industry as a whole. So such risk and estimate and uncertainties should be taken into consideration for estimation of a provision. How will you adjust this risk and uncertainty? You can adjust the risk and uncertainty against directly. You can adjust it to the present value of future obligations, which is nothing but your provision. Directly the present value can be affected or can be adjusted against the cash flows arising in future. Or can be adjusted against the discount rate applicable. Have you observed one thing? That throughout I have been using something called as present value, discount rates, etc. That means I have taken into consideration something called as time value of money. So that means whenever you find a provision and such provision is to be settled beyond 12 months period, if it is expected to be settled beyond 12 months, then the estimated future cash outflows should be discounted to present value. Discounted to present value. When you say discount to present value, I also have to emphasize upon what is the discount rate applicable as well. When I said discount it to present value, then what is the discount rate applicable? Discount rate applicable is market assessment of time value. Market assessment of time value of money. That means I am saying that whenever you find that provision is maintained for a present obligation resulting in a future cash outflow, and if such future cash flow outflow is expected to be settled beyond 12 months period, then we have to make sure that we are estimating the cash flows. How do you estimate the cash flows? He's saying such future cash outflows which you have to pay have to be discounted and presented at today's value or at the present value. Now, how do I discount it and bring it to the present value? Using an appropriate discount rate. What is the discount rate applicable? It is a market assessment of a time value of money. So what we are saying here, market assessment of time value of money normally indicated as risk-free rate of return, RF of that particular currency. Risk-free rate of return in that particular currency is the most appropriate discount rate. However, I am saying this discount rate can be adjusted to the extent of risk and uncertainty against collection. What is the amount of risk involved in the outflow? I will adjust the discount rate against the risk. That means if it is more risky, then the risk-free rate should be added by something called as risk premium. So when I talk about discount rate applicable, I can say it is risk-free rate plus risk premium. Whenever you want to adjust it with the amount of risk and uncertainty. So what are we saying? In getting a best estimate of a provision, we'll have to take into consideration all the future cash outflows. Such future cash outflows, if there is a risk and uncertainty of that cash outflow, then we'll have to make sure that we are adjusting such risk and uncertainty. To what should I adjust? I can either discount the entire cash outflows into present value and directly adjust it to the present value itself. Or you can adjust it to the cash outflow itself without discounting it to present value. Or you can directly adjust it to the discount rate applicable, because normally I'll take risk-free rate as a discount rate, but if there is a risk involved, I will add with the amount of risk premium. What is this future events and how do they affect it? Now when I look at this word future events, that means which will affect the cash outflow in future. What could affect the cash outflows in future? Something like this. He'll say that if your obligation today is 100 rupees, after 3 years, if you are discharging my obligation, you have to pay 150. Future events. Now also, it should be affected by the taxes which are applicable in future. When I say taxes applicable in future, I have a problem. Who will tell me what is the applicable tax rate of future? I don't know. So as on today's date, on the reporting date, we will have to take into consideration the taxes which are substantively enacted in India. It becomes really important, guys, because we normally give the budget in the month of February. I'm preparing my financial statements in the month of March, and the budget of February will come into effect only after it becomes a finance bill, which is subsequent. As on 31st March, the finance bill might not be applicable, but since it was already read out in the budget, it is substantively enacted. So such future tax rate will also have been taken into consideration in estimating the amount of provision to be recognized. Ultimately, we said there is a present obligation arising from a past event, results in a probable outflow of enterprise resources, reliable measurement of provision, and ultimately we come to our end and we say that such amount of provision has to be recognized and provided in your P&L. Recognition should be presented in the P&L. Now, in the P&L, normally it goes as a debit. Now, however, when it comes to presentation in the balance sheet, it should be presented as a liability. And under the liability also, I'll classify it as current or non-current. I'll present it as current or non-current. Current if it is settled within 12 months. If such provision is expected to be settled beyond 12 months period, then I will make sure that it is presented as non-current liability, non-current provisions. So provisions are also classified as current and non-current in presenting your financial and presentation of your provision in financial statements as a part of balance sheet in the liabilities. Got it? So this is my recognition and presentation, but this alone is not sufficient for me. What happens subsequently? If I have discounted a provision to its present value, what will be the impact of increase in the value of a provision for the subsequent periods? Number two, sometimes I can have a reimbursements as well. Reimbursement means I paid an amount or I have a liability to pay an amount, but at the same time I have a right to receive that amount from someone else. Then in such cases, how do I even present these items? So all these things also have to be considered in presentation of provisions in your financial statements. So let's look at what is the subsequent recognition of a provision, and if I have a reimbursement, how will it be taken into consideration in presentation of financial statements?